with which I have ever offended thee, and justly deserve thy temporal and eternal punishment. But I am heartily sorry for them, and sincerely repent of them. And I pray thee thy boundless mercy, and for the sake of the holy, innocent, bitter sufferings and death of thy beloved Son, Jesus Christ, to be gracious and merciful to me, a poor, sinful being.
Upon this, your confession, I, by virtue of my office, as a called and ordained servant of the Lord, announce the grace of God unto you, and in the stead, and by the command of my Lord, Jesus Christ, I forgive you all your sin, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost.
Thank you.
You shall stand before me. If you take out the precious from the vial, you shall be as my mouth. Let them return to you, but you must not return to them. And I will make you to this people a fortified bronze wall, and they will fight against you, but they shall not prevail against you, for I am with you to save you and deliver you, says the Lord. I will deliver you from the hand of the wicked, and I will redeem you from the grip of the terrible. Here ends the lesson. We read responsibly Psalm 126 as printed in the bulletin. When the Lord brought back the captivity of Zion, then our mouth was filled with laughter. Then they said among the nations,
the Lord has done great things for them.
The Lord has done great things for us.
And we are glad.
Bring back our captivity, O Lord.
As the streams in the south,
those who sow in tears
shall reap in joy.
He who continually goes forth weeping,
bearing seed for sowing,
shall doubtless come again with rejoicing,
bringing his sheaves with him. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen.
The holy epistle appointed for today is recorded for us in St. Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 8, verses 12 through 17. Therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh to live according to the flesh, for if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Here ends the holy epistle. Be thou my strong rock, for an house of defense to save me. In thee, O Lord, do I put my trust. Let me never be ashamed. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Give ear, O my people, to my law. Incline your ears to the words of my mouth. Hallelujah.
Thank you.
your fellow redeemed by the blood of the spotless Lamb of God, who indeed is the true teacher who sends out those who are to be true teachers. Grace, mercy, and peace are yours in abundance from God, our Heavenly Father, indeed from our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Hear the words of the Epistle lesson once again in Jesus' name. Romans 8, verses 12 through 17. Brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live according to the flesh. For if you live according to the flesh, you will die. But if by the Spirit you put to death the deeds of the body, you will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit of God, these are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you received the spirit of adoption, by whom we cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs with Christ, if indeed we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Let us pray. in baptism, truly the devil is driven out. Lord, Lord, have I not cast out demons in your name? God help me, should I hear in that day, sorry? I never knew you. Those are terribly sobering words. Terribly sobering words. What kind of God do you have? We celebrate 500 years this year of Luther posting the 95 Theses. 500 years of reformation of the church. Really, the church has always undergone reform, but that was a bit more significant one, I suppose. We claim to be the Holy Catholic Church, and you can't find us listed under Catholic churches on the internet for sure, and probably not in any history book anywhere. We're thrown among the Protestants, and we're given a tagline something like, oh, people who hold or identify with the teachings of Martin Luther, pop. That's pretty pitiful, pretty pathetic. Who would ever give us a second thought? I read it and I don't want to give us a second thought. Do we reform in the sense of doing something we want, creating a God out of our heads, creating a way of worshiping God that fits how we are comfortable worshiping? Or do we take out the precious from the vial? And when we take out the precious from the vial, looking at that which is good, right, and salutary, as we always say, their God will bless. Their God will make us his spokespeople. Do we, as God urged the church in Old Testament times to do we stand in the old paths where the good way lies? Do we seek the ancient ways? Because it is there where God promises to bless us. Or are we ourselves looking for the latest, newest thing? The people around us all do it. Why can't we? I like this. Why can't we? This makes me feel good. Why can't we? It comes down to this. You will sow to the flesh. You will from the flesh reap destruction. I would guess that when I talk about sowing to the flesh and we hear these words, the first thing we think of is sexual sins. That might have been the farthest thing from St. Paul's mind when he wrote these words. There are far different ways of sowing to the flesh. Let's break it down in these ways. Sins of the world, sins of the triumphalists, and sins of the Pharisee. Sowing to the flesh in the sense of the world is to deny what God says is good and wrong and simply go by what the world around us or what we ourselves want. To do so is, if we are looking at what our culture says is good, that is to elevate man into the place. you're going to be persecuted, you're going to suffer, and the fact of the matter is, short of Christ's return, each and every one of us will finally breathe our last breath in this world. No matter what you believe, no matter how hard you believe, this is reality. What kind of God will you be? Then there is the sins of the flesh according to the Pharisees, who believes that we can go without sinning in this life. Remember the rich young ruler? All these things I have done since I was a child. I can do this. I've got it. He broke the first table of the law. He was looking to be righteous by what he did rather than by the only way that we can be righteous, faith in Christ. If you're going to do it by your keeping of the law, first of all, then it is not by Christ, and you are disrespecting Christ and his unbelievable sacrifice that he made for you. You are looking at God the Father and saying, yeah, it's nice that you love the world in this way, you gave your only begotten Son, but I will keep your law, because I'm that good. Please don't get me wrong. Good works are just that. They're good, and they're important. And even among the unbelievers, better the person who is kind to his family and the people around him and respectful of other people's property and tells the truth. Far better than that, than one who claims to be a Christian and lies and is nasty to the people around him, etc. But good works matter. God wants good works. God rewards good works, oftentimes in the here and now, but especially in the then and there. But the fact of the matter is, unless we have faith in Christ that looks to him for salvation, there is no such thing as a good work that is truly and absolutely good in God's eyes. If we're honest with ourselves, though we may be good people, we are not perfect. And we cannot be perfect once we have not been perfect. From the moment we are conceived in the womb, by the very fact that we have human fathers, God looks at us and says, unworthy. Remember first that you cannot preach the law to yourself effectively, nor, I would argue, can you preach the gospel to yourself effectively. It must come from outside of you. And be wary of the gospel reductionists, those who say, because Christ died for all, effectively there's no sin that matters. You're home free in heaven. You can be an active homosexual. You can be a thief. You can continue in your use of drugs without being nervous about it. And it's all okay because Jesus died for you. No. No, no. Tell you the truth, we read. Those who do these things shall not inherit the kingdom of heaven. No, we cannot effectively preach the law to ourselves. It must come from outside of us. And so, if you hear those words and you fear, and you want to be done with the deeds of the flesh, and you want to be of the Spirit, then you do what you're doing here today. You come where salvation is handed out, distributed. You come recognizing that if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. And so we continue to hear that the sinful flesh may be put to death. And in Christian discipline, we go through the seasons of the year and we make efforts in the little things, even as it says in the Catechism once again, fasting and bodily preparation are indeed a fine outward training. We work with the body in the little things, so that when push comes to shove, we have the strength in the greater things, that we may truly believe these words and trust in them, given and shed for the world. And then, in the Spirit, adopted through the watery womb of the Church, holy baptism, and made the very children of God, we do not look and say, how do I get to be a child of God? How do I get to be good enough to be part of the family? But we own the name. And ask this question. God has done so much for me in his mercy. What does it mean to own his name and confess before the world that God is good, and God is kind, and God is love, and God is forgiving, so that we may not be false prophets who sow to the flesh and brush over sin and say, well, I wouldn't want to judge or condemn what somebody's doing. But in love, we warn them and say, you're separating yourself from your salvation by what you are doing. God loves you, but the only way to God is through faith in Christ. And if you are going to keep on doing what you're doing, it will not end well. It's not about condemning you in the here and now. It's about saving you in the here and now. God loves you. He's provided salvation. He wants you with him as his child. That approach to God's law is freeing. That approach to God's law is a life of joy. That approach to God's law brings truly good works, works that are truly pleasing in God's sight. So whether you're standing in front of the congregation or you're in the pew, as we go out and about in our daily lives, each and every one of us may truly prophesy in God's name, keeping that commandment not to take the name of the Lord your God for emptiness, by being faithful to what he says. Then we may truly cast out demons as we preach the gospel, which the devil cannot stand because it is so powerful and so strong. He flees from it and cannot but flee from it. Then when our Savior returns, we will hear those beautiful words. Well, good. Faithful servant, inherit the kingdom prepared for you from the foundation of the world. Amen. Please, sir. And now the peace of God, which goes beyond all understanding, keep your hearts and minds through Christ Jesus.
lift up his countenance upon thee and give